Let's talk about debugging today with very few resources. That is, no fancy resources. Usually, the things that we're trying to catch with debugging are the following. Syntax. You may have missed something in the syntax, usually mismatched parentheses or brackets. Maybe you have misspelled a keyword and things like that. Logic. There may be something wrong with the logic. Often we think that the logic is good and it does things in a certain way, but there may be different perspectives to it. We might have missed something and the program maybe does ballpark what we think it does, but it may also be doing other things. Also, you always have to wonder whether you have thought through the boundary conditions. Like, for example, the extremities of the input or the data. For example, when you're thinking of a variable running within a range, what happens when the variable assumes the extremes of the range? Do things happen then in the same way that they happen for all other values? For example, you are having a division with a variable x. Obviously, you have to think whether your variable may ever assume the value 0, because you cannot divide with 0. And things like that would be the extremities that we're talking about. System issues. Maybe you are trying to access some resources for which you do not have permissions, or your program doesn't have permissions, such as files and other resources. You may have concurrency issues, different instances of the program trying to access the same resource at the same time, and so on. Now, normally, debugging is done with a lot of advanced and fancy tools. For example, you may have tools that come with IDEs. IDEs may have extensions that are allowing you to do stepwise execution of a code, setting breakpoints, etc. Or IDEs may come with fancy tools or extensions. They may be able to show you intuitive visualizations of program structure, often cut syntactic errors, show how parentheses are matched, and so on. Also, there may be extensions that come with the IDEs that allow you to do stepwise execution of the code, to set breakpoints, and so on. Error logs. Usually, system logs provide some insight about resource accesses and things that went wrong. Also, it may be possible to do reconfigurations of error reporting on your IDE or your system that may suit your needs for debugging. It's also possible to have stack dumps or traces. Logs of program state at times of failure can be examined to determine cause, and often there are some tools in existence that allow you to trace large logs. Doing it manually is hard, but there are software tools that allow you to trace large logs. And of course, there may be a lot more, but that is outside our scope for now. What we're after right now is a very simple debugging. So assume that you ain't got nothing. That's trying to speak Southern with a Greek accent. Anyhow, what we are trying to do today is to do some simple debugging with Spartan resources, meaning basically nothing. And we are going to only assume that we can access the environment where the PHP code will run. So we just have a plain editor, which will allow us to edit our PHP code, no IDEs. And so in the following, what I will be using to do this demonstration will be an FTP client to transfer files on a Linux server, a text editor for editing the PHP programs, an SSH client to be able to log on to the server and run command line instructions right on the server, and of course a browser for running the PHP program over HTTP. In fact, I will be using WinSCP, which is a FTP client, and it also has a built-in editor, so I can double-click on a file and open it for editing, and whatever changes I make, they can commit to the server right away. I will also be using an SSH client, such as PuTTY, to be able to log on to the server and run commands from command line. and of course a browser for running a PHP program over HTTP, that is, over the web. Now, before we begin, it would be good to know what is the logic of the program that we'll be debugging. So let me describe what the program that I will be debugging is supposed to do, or what I expect it to be able to do. First, this program will be a combination of a form and a handler at the same time. So this program will be displaying a form, and the form will be submitting to that program itself and using it as a handler as well. So if the program is accessed for the first time, it will only display a form and then it will terminate. If it's accessed as a handler, i.e. if a form was submitted to it, and so there is input data submitted to it, therefore it is expected to act as a handler, then it will do the following. It will open a server file and list its contents. Then it will list the contents of the file again, but this time it will do some string replacement acrobatics before it does that, using regular expressions and the like, we're going to see. And it will also append user input obtained via this same form to the file itself, thereby augmenting its contents. So here's the program that we're going to be debugging. And let's go quickly over it and see the various parts of it. So this is PHP code, therefore it is embedded in HTML. So after printing some header stuff, we're getting into this PHP code. And what this PHP code is, it will print a form. Notice that it will do this if some variable, first visit, is empty. So in other words, it has not been set to any value before. So if that happens, then this variable is going to grab the name of this file. So even if you rename this file, it will still work, because this variable will always contain the name of this file. And then we have a form that will be printed from here to here. So you see over here we have the action part, which is submitting to this same program with a post method, and then we have a input over here. We have an input text box over here that will collect some user info. Then we have a variable over here that is hidden. So it is preset to something, but the user cannot change it because it will not render for the user to see it. Of course, the user can always look at the source code of the HTML file that is generated and see it, but for our purposes, this will work to have a hidden variable that does not render set to some whatever value here, and then close the form after a submit button. Then close the HTML, which started up here, because once the form is printed, the program is going to die. So it's going to quit and it's not going to continue from there on. So we need to close the tags that were opened over here, because it's not going to happen anywhere else. Now, important thing to note, this hidden variable, if this form is used and submitted, it will be submitted to this same handler. And now this variable will be set. It will be set to this value. So it will not be empty. So if this run is the result of a form submitting to this handler, then this variable will not be empty, and therefore this part will be skipped. So the program will not terminate over here, and it will continue further down. So continuing further down, we have more PHP code that does the following. First, a string is defined to be set to the path of a file that we're going to open. And then if that file exists, then a message will be printed that the file exists. Otherwise, it will print that the file does not exist, if the file doesn't exist at all. Then we want to read the lines of the file into some array in order to be able to go over them later. Then what we do is we go over the lines that were read from the file. We go over this array and we print the line numbers and the contents of its line. Then we print a horizontal line over here. And then we go on to do a few more acrobatics. This defines an array with some words of our choice. This happens to be a bunch of fruits and the word book. Then we're defining a string as follows. We take all the parts of the fruits array and we implode them, which means that we take all the parts of the fruits array and we string them together using this, whatever is in the quotes, as glue. So we have one expression, one string, that consists of all of these strings, where in between all these strings, this substring is going to be used as glue to hold them together. Next, we change that string to put in front of it a forward slash and a left parenthesis character, and at the end to put a right parenthesis, a forward slash, and the flag I. We're doing that using concatenation. Now, the logic of this is that we're making a regular expression. So we're making a regular expression that essentially will contain all of these words which are glued using the vertical bar, which in a regular expression stands for the logical OR. So in other words, we have cherry or orange or pear or apple and so on. Now before the vertical bar, we also put an S and question mark. The question mark in regular expressions means zero or one occurrence of whatever it is applied to. Now this one applies to S. So all these keywords may or may not have an S at the end of them. And we're going to see in the following why that is, but for now, suffice it to say that we are making a regular expression by stringing up all these keywords that are in the array fruits, gluing them together with an OR, a logical OR, putting everything in parentheses, and then using the forward slash at the beginning and at the end in order to turn this into an actual regular expression, and then using the I flag for case insensitivity whenever we're trying to do any match. Then what we do is we have another for each loop. Now we don't have key value pairs here, we only have just one variable, the line. So for each one of the contents of the lines array, which if you remember is all the stuff that we read from the file that we opened, and each one becoming in turn a value for the variable line, do the following. We have a string that is made by replacing whatever matches this regular expression in this string and have whatever matches there replaced with this. What is this? This is a variable, it's a special variable that indicates the match itself. So $1 will contain whatever was matched by the regular expression in the string. And whatever was matched will be replaced by itself and also with these bold beginning and ending tags for making sure that in HTML this part is going to be rendered as bold. Then we also replace the substring the, but only if it can be found within word boundaries. Therefore, it will replace the word the if it is not part of another word. That's why we need the word boundaries over here to make sure that this is not a substring of another word. Like, for example, there. This would be part of the word there, but it would not match in there because in the word there, you do have a boundary over here, but you do not have a word boundary here because there's more characters of the word after this. So replace the word the, if it is included in boundaries, with a. And again, with the bolds. So we get a new value of the string XX by replacing in the old XX all the words the with a. Then we print that we got XX from the original line, this original line. And then we continue and we open the file again, but this time we open it for appending. If the file cannot be opened, then the program will die with this message. Can't open the file. Now, this is a logical OR, so it has two arguments. This is the first argument, and this is the second argument. In order for the OR to succeed, the OR operation, in other words, to succeed, then either this must succeed or this must succeed. And of course, the first thing that will be tried will be this one. The interpreter will try the first argument first. It will do whatever it can to prove it true. And of course, in trying to do so, in evaluating it, it will execute it, and so this file should open. But if for any reason the file cannot open, then this will fail, and then the other argument will be tried, and of course, evaluating it, i.e. executing it, means that the program is going to terminate and not continue any further. But assuming that everything went okay and the file was open, then we write into the file this variable. This variable, if you remember, was part of the form over here. All right. So we assume that that variable will have the contents of that text box, which is whatever the user put in there. And then that will be written into the file. And then, of course, the file will be closed and the program will terminate by announcing that I'm done. We still have some more HTML over here, but if everything goes as planned, then the program will die over here and this will not be printed. So this is the program that that we have, and as we're going to see, it just doesn't run. So let's call it with a browser. So as you see, calling it with a browser, we get nothing back, no response. So we need to figure out what's wrong. So the first and easiest thing that I can do is to connect with SSH to the server and try to run the program from command line, because the interpreter will give me some information about why the program is not running. So on the server, here is my program, and I'm going to say PHP and then the program name. And as you see, when I try to run it, I get an indication over here that there is a syntax error. So what it tells me is that on line 34, there is an unexpected else. So let's go back to our program and go to line 34 and see what is going on. This is what it was complaining about. Now, notice that when an interpreter or even a compiler reports an error, it might not be that particular spot where the error exists. And an error might actually exist before. It's just that it was not realized by the interpreter or the compiler that there was an error until it could not make sense out of it anymore. In this particular case, it seems to be pretty accurate because, as you see, this else sticks to this if. The condition for the if is this, and then the statement to be executed would be this one. It starts with this bracket, but there is no closing bracket. So the else is encountered before this bracket is closed. So we know that we have an error, and in fact, this is it. We will need to then put this bracket here, save the file, and then try to run it again. So we have another error over here, which appears to be on line 54. It says that an unexpected in exists on line 54. So if we go to that place, that's this one right here. So it's complaining about this. And yes, this is the problem. It should be as, not in, because the syntax for the for each requires over here the keyword as, not the keyword in. So we save the program again, and then we go to execute again. Ha! So you see now it actually did run. So if we go on our web browser and try to refresh, aha, now it does run. And we are getting the form as we were supposed to be getting it. As a matter of fact, if we see the source code, you see, I have over here everything that the PHP program was supposed to print in terms of the form. And the hidden variable is also included. So now, let's say I go and put some text over here, like this, and then submit this. Okay. So I submitted it. Obviously, something happened because this cleared, which means that the form was submitted to the server, but the server submitted back the same form to me. All right, so what's going on here? Obviously, this is running, and so this can't be a syntax error. It has to be a logical error, and I have to go and looking what's going on. So my variable, the hidden variable, as I saw when I listed the source code of the file, was there. So it was submitted. And so this can't be empty. It has to have this value. So one simple way of checking on this is, before I get there, I introduce statements, print statements, to figure out what the values of critical variables are, or even to see how far the program went. So for example, I'm going to put over here print the value of this there. So this should print me the value of this variable right here. So let's see again. And I get nothing. According to my program, I should be getting in here. Of course, I have to save my change, so then I can go and run it again, and it's telling me that it's empty. Okay, so what do you suppose happens here? Well, let's take a look. where would this assume its value? Looking before this, actually nothing happens. This input is submitted to the handler with this key associated with this value. But where does this variable assume the value associated with this key? So looking into this, I forgot something. And what I forgot was, in fact, to extract the key value pairs into variables. So what I need to do is, I need to do this. I need to use the extract function to take from the post hash the key value pairs and then turn them into local variables. So let's try it now. Save it and go and resubmit this. Reset. Aha! So you see now what happens is that the value of the key first visit, the hidden input, is what we set it, and a local variable has been created that assumes that value. So now this test does not succeed, and so the form is skipped, and the program goes on over here. Now before we go on, let's check the contents of the file that's been opened for reading. And that file is this. These are the contents of the file, just a text file. All right, so let's just remember this picture and let's see what the program is doing. So it says that this file does exist as it's supposed to. Okay, it says that it exists, and then it reads all the file contents into this array. So this array assumes the file contents, and then we have this message printed, and then we go over this array line by line and we print the contents of the array. So this is what has happened over here. Okay, line 0 is this and line 1 is this. So these are the contents of the file printed in that format. Then we have a horizontal line printed, and then after the horizontal line we have the contents of the file printed again after the acrobatics that we mentioned earlier, where we replace these words with themselves but enclosed in bold tags, and also replacing the article the with a. So let's see about that. So here we go. This is the first line. So we got fruits in Suits book from this line. Then we got this line from this line, and so on. But as you see, the bolds that we were expecting are not there. They're not there. So something is wrong with our expression. So let's take a close look at it. So what do you think is happening over here? This is where that replacement should take place. And as you see here, if we view the source, we have a lot of bold opening and closing tags, one right after the other, so they have basically no effect. Okay. But we do not have keys like book, words like book or cherry or anything like that actually bolded. So what's going on? So this is the part that actually doesn't do the job that it's supposed to be doing. Judging from the fact that we get the bold opening and closing tags, something is trying to replace empty spaces here, but it seems that this never assumes any value. The only logical way for this to happen is that this is empty. So empty spots are replaced with the bold opening and closing tags with the empty spot itself in between. So the reasonable thing to do is to check, first of all, what exactly is the regular expression that we are trying to match here. So what we're going to do is we're going to insert a print statement here that will print us the regular expression so that we can see it and verify that it is what we think it is. Actually, let's make this one a paragraph so it's more prominent and easier to see. Save this and then go back to the browser and resend and look what we get. The regular expression is not what we expected it to be. So what it does have is the forward slash and the opening parenthesis. And it does have the closing parenthesis and the forward slash and the I in the end, but nothing in between. All right, let's see how that happens. This is where the regular expression is formed, or where it's finished forming. So we have the opening bracket, the forward slash and the opening bracket. We have this, but this one seems to be empty. Okay, why is it empty? We could try to print its value right before this one, but I can just see now that there is a mistake. It's misspelled. You see, first we have this preparation of the regular expression, and then we have another step in its preparation which involves the previous value, but this one has two S's over here, and this one has only one S. So this variable is not the same as this variable. This variable here has just been used for the first time. So it will be created right now, and its value will be null. It will be empty. So this variable, the same as this, the same as this, this variable will become what? It will become this, concatenated with an empty value, and concatenated with this. And that is why this turns out to be the way it is. This value is not used, it's overwritten. Okay, so this step right here is overwritten by this step. So that's lost. So what we need to do is we need to correct this one and make sure that we get the right variable. So if we do and we save it, then we go back to our program and then we refresh. Ah, see now the regular expression is what we want it to be. It has the cherry and the orange and the pear and the apple and so on with an optional S at the end. Remember that the question mark applies to the S and it means zero or one occurrence of an S. Okay, like this. So now, since this is right, do you see how these keywords, these words that are included in here, appear in bold? Okay, they appear in bold. Like this. Also, the words have been replaced with a bold A word. Notice that this or this does not match because the T is capital, and we did not do a case sensitive matching for the word. This one has oranges, which match the plural because of this S over here, and everything works the way it's supposed to work, except this part tells me that it cannot open this file. So let's take a look at it and see what's happening there. That is this. That message comes from this. We're trying to open a file over here and tells me that it cannot open the file. Obviously, I do not have a syntax mistake over here, because then the program would have crashed. But the thing is that right here, this is trying to happen, but it does not happen, and instead this one happens. So why can't I open the file? Let's go back to our server and let's try the PHP again. Of course, I get first visit. So let's try to run our program from command line again. So if I try to run it from command line again, expectedly, I'm going to get the form again, because running it from command line submits no input, no query string to the script. And so that variable, the first visit variable, is going to be empty. So in order to get past this, I have to fool it and make it think that it gets some input. So the way to fool my program will be right after the extract, where all the input is processed, I'm going to go and hard code values for these variables. So I'm going to insert a value for this variable, and also I'm going to insert a value for my text, which would be a variable that would have been created by extract should a user had submitted this field with something. So let's put over here something to test. And to be able to recognize it, let's change it a little bit. All right, so let's save the file, and then let's go and run it again. So let's go run this again. So now, since it did receive inputs, it did not print the form, and it executed the program, and it seems like it has completed as expected. It has printed this done string as our program was expected to do. So let's see. The test file that we see over here is the one that is supposed to be written, appended with the input that we provided, which if we recall, it was this. So if we go back and check the contents of the file, there you go, it's here. At the end of the file, we have the previous contents, and then at the end of the file, we have this string printed. So our program runs fine from command line. But if we go to the web and we try to run it from the web, then it does not run. So obviously there's nothing wrong here with the program itself. There is no syntax error, for example, or anything like that, because if there was, it shouldn't run from either place. But this one runs from command line, but doesn't run from the web. this file cannot be opened, and that's the problem. So if we look at the place that it fails right here. It cannot open this file. So this is what does not happen. It happens when I run it from command line, but it does not happen when I run it from the web. So that's a resource. This file is a resource that I cannot use. So let's check and see what exactly is going on with this resource. This is the file. And here is what the problem is. You see, when I run it from command line, this program runs as me with my privileges. These are the privileges of the user. These are the privileges of the group of the user. And the last three would be the privileges of everybody else, the universe, that is. So when I'm running it over command line, then the program runs with my privileges. So it is possible to read it and to write it. But when I'm doing it over the web, then it's running with these privileges, which means that it can be opened for reading, but it cannot be opened for writing. You cannot rewrite this file. So that's exactly the problem. When I'm trying to open this file for appending, which means that I would be writing to it, then I can't do it. I don't have the privileges to do it. So what's the fix? Well, I'm going to change the privileges of this, and I'm going to put, I'm going to open it to everybody for right now. And so here is the new privileges for this file. Obviously, the entire universe has permissions to read it, write it, and execute it. Not a good idea to leave it executable by the universe. But for now, I just need to demonstrate. So if I go on the web now and I refresh my file and resend, now it is done. Now it was able to open the file and actually do what the program was instructing it to do. There we are. So let's try it again. Send this. It was done. And it keeps writing the same string. That is because I forgot that I have hard-coded the variables. So I need to remove the hard codings that I use to run it from command line. So I'm simply going to quote this out, save the file, and then go and run it from the web by resending what? Basically, I'll be resending this string here. And again, it was done successfully. So if I go to the server and I try to look at the file again, here is my statement. All right, so these are a couple of tricks that you can do to debug your programs with minimal resources, basically command line, browser, and how you go looking about it. The main things that I did was to go and put statements to print values and check on values in the program. I also ran the program from command line to see what the interpreter would tell me. And I snooped around to make sure that files, as the resources that I'm trying to access, had appropriate permissions to let me do what I was supposed to do. Now, there is no algorithm, of course, to doing this, but I hope that this gives you some idea about how you go about snooping around the code and trying to figure out what's wrong. Okay, that's all for now. Thank you.